We come from all over Europe, from across borders, different party lines, at least party affiliations of the past, and with different views of the good society. We are united by these differences. Europe will be democratized or it will disintegrate. This is not a scare tactic, it is a fact. The European Union's disintegration is happening. New divisions, new walls are springing up along borders, inside our societies, in people's minds. Friends, comrades, fellow travelers, welcome to Prague. Those words are not new. They are the words with which DiEM25 was born on the 9th of February 2016 at the Volksbühne Theatre. It was a passionate night, at the end of which thousands of Europeans joined the Democracy in Europe movement. It was a good night. And it is wonderful to see so many of you who were at the Volksbühne that night, being here today in Prague, bringing that passion after 3.5 tumultuous years to the Czech Republic. Our collective task was to create the first transnational progressive movement, not merely a confederacy behind a solid, common, anti-austerity, green feminist, radical humanist program, a program that ends Europe's surrender to the twin authoritarianisms of the establishment troikas on the one hand, and of, on the other hand, assorted varieties of neo-fascism. That night, we were swept away by the passion in the Volksbühne. I'm glad that this passion, as I said before, today is in Prague, a city that in our hearts and minds we shall always associate with the importance of bringing the spring through rebellion independently and without considering whether we're going to win or lose. Comrades, fellow travelers, friends, this is not, however, the time for self-congratulation. Passion has returned to politics, but not in a manner that we wanted. As DiEM25, we predicted 4 years ago that capitalism's major spasm, which began in 2008, would continue after 2016 with the imposition of austerity for the many and socialism for the few. And as we predicted, as DiEM25 predicted, the result was a toxic passion that fueled not humanism, but misanthropy. Instead of energizing progressives, it was the ultra-right that grew more passionate, vibrating with an anti-establishment fervor that led to the rise of what we, DiEM25, called a nationalist internationale, a nationalist international. Today, almost 4 years since DiEM25 was born, the establishment that caused Europe's worst crisis since the 1940s remains fully in control of the levers of power, while the nationalist international reinforces the status quo by being the only serious recipient of the people's anger, of the people's wrath. A sure measure of a regime's fragility is the disconnect, the distance between reality and propaganda. And a sure measure of the health of a democracy is the extent to which the demos, the people, can challenge the regime when this distance between reality and propaganda becomes unbearable. On these two measures, Europe has never been more fragile and never has been less democratic than it is today. So unfortunately, yes, we were right. Brexit did not happen a few months after Diem, 6 months or so after Diem was created. Brexit did not happen because people like us, our movement, opposed the European Union. Brexit happened because good people in Britain, not racists or anti-Europeans, but good people, could not stomach Brussels and Frankfurt's arrogance and authoritarianism. When we were campaigning in Britain before the referendum that led to Brexit on behalf of DiEM25, and this is something we should be proud of, wonderful comrades across Britain would come up to us and say, look, we like you and your movement, but mate, there's no way I'm going to vote to remain in this European Union after the way in which Brussels treated your people. The sheer contempt for democracy, which I experienced personally in the Eurogroup, and everybody is experiencing in their nooks and crannies around Europe, the sheer contempt for democracy had become evident to many anti-racist progressives in Britain. And it was their vote that tipped the balance in favor of Brexit at 1.8%. As was the awful insight that all the establishment figures, from Christine Lagarde, Barack Obama, to Wolfgang Schäuble and David Cameron, they were warning them, threatening them, that if they dare vote for Brexit, they would be severely punished. A sure way of turning courageous voters and citizens off the European Union, against the European Union. Of course, DiEM25 was perfectly right to campaign against Brexit. The European Union's disintegration will undoubtedly only reinforce deflationary forces that are the nationalist international's best friends. We saw this in Britain. We saw it in France. We saw it in Italy, in Poland, in Hungary, everywhere. Euroscepticism will always feed the xenophobic beast and at the same time strengthen the establishment, as the majority at some point recoils from Euroscepticism. Brexit, Fraxit, Lexit, recoils from it in horror. At that moment, progressive movements like DiEM25, we get squeezed badly between the two sides of the same coin. The authoritarianism of the establishment and the authoritarianism of the nationalist international. That was our experience as we campaigned against Brexit on a radical Remain progressive agenda with our comrades Jeremy Corbyn and John McDonnell of the Labour Party. We were also right to predict the demise of existing left-of-centre forces, movements and parties. The Social Democrats, we said back then at the Volksbühne, would never recover after having espoused financialization and austerity. The European Left Party, we predicted, would choose oblivion if it chose to cover up Syriza's capitulation to the Troika, while still embracing Eurosceptic forces elsewhere. Podemos would fizzle out as a result of their refusal to work with movements like DiEM25 to put together a coherent progressive agenda for Europe. The Greens would never be transformational given their adoption of austerian ordoliberalism. We were also right, on the one hand, to support Emmanuel Macron against Le Pen in the second round of the French presidential election, but also to oppose him the day after, accurately predicting that his Eurozone reform agenda was dead on arrival, given his determination not to confront the European establishment, leaving him no option other than neoliberalism at home and Euro-jingoism abroad. Finally, our central idea was spot on. It was absolutely right. The idea of program-led transnational politics, of creating a movement that seeks to unite all progressives behind a Green New Deal for Europe. Unity through coherence, instead of opportunistic confederacies or confluences. Lest we forget, the Troika, the neo-fascists, the bankers, always share a tight, internationalist, coherent, common agenda. It is internationalism at work. That's what finance and fascism points to. It is about time. It was about time, we said in 2016, that progressives develop our own coherent transnational agenda. We were right, DiEM25 was right, to invite all progressives interested in such an agenda to sit down around the table with us and help us forge the Green New Deal for Europe. But, comrades, fellow travelers, friends, we were also wrong. We underestimated the establishment's capacity to put a lid on the economic crisis, not to resolve the economic crisis, but to turn disintegration into permanent corrosive stagnation. At the expense of spreading discontent and Euroscepticism, even into traditional social democratic and Christian democratic territories, circles, the establishment stabilized the Eurozone. They succeeded in stabilizing it. How did they do it? By concealing the bankruptcies without making them go away. By zombifying unsustainable banks, unsustainable states, and unsustainable corporations. And by making the majority live in fear that while they understood that their future and the future of their children was bleak, to live in fear that it would become bleaker if they dared oppose the new ordo-liberal order post-2015-2016. And that meant that the rest, who remained angry and refused to succumb to anger because they opted for rage, they only had the xenophobic nationalist international to turn to. A timely reminder of how fascism always served the system by offering its victims an opportunity to vent their anger without threatening the established order. We were also wrong to hope that major progressive parties like Die Linke, Podemos, might be attracted to, be persuaded by us, and may want to adopt a solid, convincing Green New Deal for Europe. The program that DiEM25 developed painstakingly, calling upon all of them to participate, and some of them did participate. Podemos did send people. Die Linke did send people. But we were wrong to think that they would be interested in adopting that policy program and running with it. They were not interested. They proved beyond reasonable doubt that they were never interested in progressive policy agendas, preferring the old style of politics that turned most people off. We were right, of course, to persevere with our cohesive, progressive, program-led transnationalism. We soldiered on, making huge concessions to partners that joined us. We even changed our name, effectively, from DiEM25 to the European Spring to attract them, for their sake. In the end, we failed to elect a single member of European Parliament, even though we did attract around 1.5 million votes across Europe. Put bluntly, let's be honest, our program-led transnationalism failed to take off. A failure that was particularly painful in the one country we had banked on, Germany, where we gathered 125,000 votes instead of the 300,000 that we had targeted. Of course, that failure reflected another misprediction. Back in 2016, we imagined that some enlightened centrists would wish to contribute financially to our electoral campaign. Remember that? We thought that they, because of enlightened selfishness, they would recognize that DiEM25 is an important pro-European radical for them, but pro-European voice. It didn't work out. The only money we got, every single euro, came from DiEMers. This is simultaneously a blessing in disguise, but also a reminder that the system is not even smart at knowing what is good for it. What did we do well? And what did we do badly? We succeeded in building the first transnational pan-European movement. If anything, events since 2016 proved that only such a movement holds hope for real change. But we failed to ignite DiEM25. Spending too much precious energy, navel-gazing, looking inwards into the movement, with our membership being stuck at the size that it had 2 years ago. We haven't really grown. We succeeded in combining horizontality with verticality within our movement in an attempt to avoid the perils both of movements like the World Social Forum, total horizontality, or the perils of a Stalinist top-down verticality. We combined horizontality in the form of spontaneous collectives, DSCs, sortition, think of our validating council, with the top-down coordinating service of the coordinating collective of national collectives. But we failed to bring these two dimensions together sufficiently to inspire amongst all DiEMers a sense that they, you, are in control of the movement. We succeeded in putting together the only Green New Deal agenda that is worthy of its name. An agenda that we should be very proud of. An agenda that is uniquely able to appeal simultaneously to demonstrators on the streets, to the youngsters, even to Extinction Rebellion activists, while at the same time making financiers lose their words when they try to explain why they are not for it. But we failed to make our Green New Deal prominent. We were the first ones to come out with this. After that, many Green New Deals proliferated. They are not worthy of the name. They are empty shirts. You read them and you lose the will to live. And yet, very few Europeans identify the Green New Deal with our Green New Deal. We succeeded in creating electoral wings, one of which is now in Greece's parliament, and in bringing together the European Spring to contest the European Parliament elections, but we failed to make a difference in frontline states like Italy and to elect MEPs where we did run. We succeeded in initiating the Progressive International together with the Sanders Institute a year ago in Vermont and to forge a crucial alliance with Jeremy Corbyn and John McDonnell of the British Labour Party. But we failed to take the Progressive International further. While in the United Kingdom, DiEM25 UK has not taken full advantage of our privileged relation with the Labour Party, the Labour Party's leadership, or even our own potential across the land. What must we do now? What must DiEM 2.0 look like and be like? DiEM 2.0 must begin by deepening our democratic processes within our movement. We are already doing it as part of this assembly. We have to put our money where our mouth is, establishing, for instance, DiEM25 assemblies, selected by sortition, to help shape our progressive agenda for Europe on transparency, on migration, on the Green New Deal, on the European Constitution process, and so on. We must revisit our policy on alliances, while focusing on building up our electoral wings and the movement. We must eschew opportunistic confluences, confederacies, but at the same time, avoid the path of lonely Puritan solitude. We must further develop the Green New Deal for Europe, which is a major pillar of strength for us, the Progressive International, and as I said before, our special relationship with the leadership of the Labour Party in Britain. We must throw a bridge over to the Eurosceptic Progressive Commons, the Lexiteers. This clash between DiEM25 and progressive Eurosceptics must be overcome. DiEM25 must convince them that we too believe that the European Union is unreformable, that no amount of smart arguments and good policy agendas can convince the European Union cartel to change its ways. That without a clash with the institutions of late financialized European capitalism, there will be no transition to sustainably shared prosperity. We have to convince them that our agenda will automatically trigger a Brussels backlash, including a threat to expel any government that adopts a DiEM agenda from the Eurozone, from the European Union. We have to convince the Lexitiers, progressive Eurosceptics, that our radical Europeanism can uniquely expose the establishment's rejection of a proper union, and we have to expose the establishment's readiness to sacrifice Europe as a price for turning Europe into a permanent iron cage of austerity. We must also move beyond calls for more democracy. DiEM 2.0 must plan for post-capitalism. We have been criticized, and I believe justly, for appearing to tinker at the edges of an unreformable, catastrophic, rentier-based, climate-destroying capitalism, financialized capitalism. DiEM 2.0 must develop our program for overcoming capitalism. Our Green New Deal must be seen to be the first stepping stone to a better future. We must now inspire people with a vision of what follows capitalism, what follows the Green New Deal, a proper democracy where no one can buy shares in a company unless they work in it. A world where there are no longer any private banks and where everyone has a bank account with a central bank. A society that grants a trust fund for every baby born. This is not the time or the place to articulate a full pillar for post-capitalism. But it is the time to signal an intention to do so. The seeds of our post-capitalism pillar are already in our program and in what we have been doing for the last 4 years. DiEM 2.0 must water those seeds so that soon we can harvest a post-capitalist agenda around which young and old people from across Europe, indeed from beyond Europe, can organize. Friends, comrades, fellow travelers, progressive forces today are in retreat at a time of capitalism's deepest crisis. Who is to blame? The media? The oligarchy? Facebook? Putin? No. We are. It is the result of our grand failure. Social Democrats unleashed the bankers and invented austerity with Steinbrück and Timmermans calling for austerity before Schäuble and Merkel got a chance. The Greens succumbed also to ordoliberalism, even daring argue against our Green New Deal on what basis? That the 500 billion euros per annum to be invested in the green transition, Sven Giegold said this in a debate with me in Germany, is too much money to spend on the green transition because, and I quote, of capacity constraints the private sector. Who needs Schäuble when you have the German Greens? Syriza surrendered to the Troika, eventually celebrating the Troika's memorandum of understanding as the program that would get the Greek people out of debtor's prison, out of the crisis. And what was the result? On the 7th of July, they lost to New Democracy. And far worse, they created, they built the foundation, having adopted in the name of the left, the Troika's catastrophic Troika austerity and privatization program. They built the foundation on which the current neoliberal authoritarian New Democracy government is building a new parasitic oligarchy. That was the work of Syriza. The European Party of the Left. Well, they've chosen oblivion by becoming a bureaucratic armada of sinking vessels. Lexiteers, they're fading everywhere after having inadvertently reinforced right-wing Euroscepticism. What about our friends in Spain? Having failed to distance itself in the summer of 2015 from Syriza and from the Lexiteers at one and the same time, Podemos has become a shadow of itself, a sidekick of a half-baked pseudo-socialist government, lacking any interest in clashing with the establishment or articulating a progressive European agenda. In the midst of this gloom, our own defeats as DMS included, DiEM25 has managed to do one thing we promised in 2016, to stop cursing the darkness and to light a small candle. That small candle is MeRA25 in Greece. Despite the demonization and the absurd lack of funding, DiEMers, all of you, or many of you, from across Europe, came to Greece and helped us do the impossible. Put our electoral wing in Greece, MeRA25, into Greece's parliament. Why did we succeed in Greece? Three reasons. First, while others, like Syriza, were telling voters, if you don't vote for us, things are going to get worse. Or the Communist Party that was saying, first, we establish socialism, and then good things will happen. Unlike that, what we said was, we showed them our pan-European agenda that could make a difference tomorrow morning. Secondly, because we combined the transnational with the patriotic, the Green New Deal for Europe and the prospect of the progressive international with programs tailor-made for our crisis-stricken people. And thirdly, this is a criticism, a self-criticism of DiEM25, because we managed in Greece to go beyond the cool crowd of academics, students, artists, cosmopolitans, which DiEM25 already appeals to. And we managed to speak to the heart of the uncool crowd of taxi drivers, blue-collar workers, pensioners, school children. Friends, comrades, fellow travelers, embracing the uncool crowd, combining transnational humanism with non-nativist patriotism, deepening democracy within our movement, building our movement while extending our alliances, the Progressive International in particular, supplementing our Green New Deal with a post-capitalism pillar. That's what DiEM 2.0 should be about. Yes, we need a radically different, revived DiEM25. But we also need to preserve continuity with our courageous first 3.5 years. I can think of no better way of pushing us along this path of renewal with continuity than by quoting the last words with which we concluded at the Volksbühne Theatre on that cold February night in 2016 in Berlin. The real danger is not that we shall aim too high and miss. The real danger is that we will be looking, training our eyes on the floor, and end up there. So let us celebrate today. But from tomorrow, let's shake Europe. Gently, compassionately, but firmly. Carpe diem.